This is John Clayton. Give him a hand, folks.
I just want to welcome you here and acknowledge that this is a fantastic occasion, a fantastic day. We get to be a part of this man's genius and dig into that special brain and soul of his. How lucky can you be? And this is again brought to you by ASMAC. And if you don't know ASMAC, this is probably one of the one of the most important things that we do, which is bring composers, arrangers together, and allow them to share with you their trade secrets, their techniques, their philosophies, their ideas. It kind of doesn't happen anywhere else like this, so it's really special. But this isn't the only thing that we do. We also have luncheons each month, whereby we invite great writers that we can, that are here, or even that are visiting from out of town, to kind of talk about themselves and tell us about their lives and what they do in a really casual luncheon setting. It's awesome as well. Not as masterclass hands-on, it's still very, very revealing and informative, and just very fun to be able to get that close to these people who are musically admired for so long. So, the luncheons, these master classes, we also have every year, every other year, a chance where we really do a Golden Score award that allows us to really pay tribute. John Mandel has been a recipient of one of these awards, as have people like Quincy Jones, Lalo Schifrin, on down the line. So it's a really cool thing. So a lot of great things happen in this organization. If you're not a member, we really encourage you to come on in with the family. It's really what it is. So without further ado, we're going to turn it over to Kim Richmond and John Mandel.
So here you see the credits for John. John, did we leave anything off? We probably did.
Well, the only thing you left off is something I'm going to mention right now. The man who probably was more responsible for starting the Arrangers Society and back in the mid-40s, I believe, is sitting back there wearing, looking dapper as usual, wearing a hat. Yeah, and if it wasn't for Van Alexander, I probably wouldn't be sitting here right now. And, well, that's a story in itself, but he taught me more in 15 minutes than I've learned ever since about how you do it and what it is and the whole thing. Because, I won't go into that story. We'll go on from here.
Good.
Yeah. Well, I discovered that what made a band sound good and what didn't make a band sound good. You know, we had, what I didn't realize is that it, you know, like most kids in the early 40s and late 30s that were interested in music and, you know, guys that were doing this, like Al Cohn and just a whole bunch of us that came up at the same time. Al Cohn, Manny Album, all those guys. Bill Holman, I think, came along a little later, but he's here, and he's been a big influence on me ever since. Not necessarily a good one. In fact, we lived together for a while, and I think we were both going through divorces, and it was truly the odd couple. But it was fun.
Who was the neat one?
What?
Who was the neat one?
Oh, I don't know. Probably there wasn't any. But like most kids at that time who were interested in music, you know, as we grew up going through our teen years, listening to, you know, with the glued to the radio, because we'd hear all these bands. Swing had taken over, you know, for a very short time. popular music and good music were synonymous for a while after the swing craze broke out. And there was a big, there was a band in every, at every hotel. This is starting in 1937, 8, 9. And all these bands were playing, had to play the same 10 songs. And they'd bring you, you know, Tommy Dorsey from high atop the Astor roof or something. And terrible bands, too, you know, the whole bunch of Mickey Mouse bands in the Midwest, Dick Durgan's, and oh, we'd get some. At any rate, they all had to play the same songs. And so this was like, I didn't realize it at the time, nobody did, but this was like the greatest laboratory at all, of all things, you know, being able to, you'd hear a song that everybody, you know, the publishers ran the business, so they just made sure everybody, they wanted to get their song on the hit parade. That was the zenith. So all these bands would have to play the same 10 songs that were on the hit parade. You had this laboratory, kind of, except we didn't see it at the time, of a song that, I'd be laying there at night, probably, after lights out, saying, my God, this song, I don't know why everybody's making such a fuss over it. It really kind of sucks. And then another band would come on, somebody like Tommy Dorsey, and they'd play the same song, and it sounded wonderful. Then I said, wait a minute. And then another band would come on, like, who knows, Sammy Kay or somebody like that, and it would sound dreadful. And I really got confused, and it took about 2 weeks or 3 weeks for the light bulb to go on over my head. And I said, wait a minute, it's not the song at all, it's the way the band plays it. And why, how, and somebody writes the music and makes a song either sound good or bad. And I found out that whoever did that was called an arranger. Nobody knew what an arranger was, including me. They thought it was somebody who moved chairs around or something. And the only things I read in those days were Downbeat and Metronome. That's why I'm so literate today. At any rate, I always saw the name Van Alexander, and I saw a little notice in there that Van was taking students. This is after about a year of living with Metronome and Downbeat. And I said, oh boy, I hit on my mother really hard. And she said, okay. I said, this is what you want to do? And I went up to see Van, who was living up in an apartment. He had his first baby, which was probably why he had to turn to taking people like me and the students. And I must have been, what was it? Was that 14 or 15, something like that, Van? Maybe 13. And I convinced him this is what I wanted to do. He said, all right. He goes over to a closet that he had right opposite the door, you know, across the living room, and pulls out a huge stack of music, and reaches up on top and pulls out this score. Or a bunch of yellow paper, and brings it over and opens it up. And I said, what's that? He says, this is a score. I said, what's a score? He said, this is a snapshot of what everybody in the band is doing for 8 bars, all at the same time. And then I saw everybody was in a different key, you know, everything was written transposed. I didn't know any of that. Within 15 minutes, he had shown me pretty much what I know now. That was it. He said, here's what it looks like. And then he says, you see what it looks like now? This was maybe 15 minutes later. And he said, now you're going to hear what it sounds like. And he pulled out one of his brand new Bluebird records. And my eyes are just bugging out. I said, my God, this is the real deal here. And it was a song called Hooray for Spinach, which was like a nice Harry Warren song. You know, it's not as horrible as you think. It was pretty good. And he went through the whole thing, turning pages and playing the record. And I said, oh my God, to myself. In 15 minutes, he taught me about as much as I know now. Because then he said, go home, and he threw me in the water and yelled, swim, which was, he said, go home and write something. He gave me a big blank pad of yellow paper. And that's what it, that's really how it went from there. I'd come in and see him every couple of weeks, and he'd say, well, go through. At any rate, he was always encouraging, said, you know, you can do this, and you can, you know, you can use the base if you want to. You can give him bowed stuff. It was just, he was always the most supportive. And now he, and he's, in addition to that, he formed the First Arranger Society with some, quite a few other people. And we're here now because of that. And Van?
Yeah, Van.
Yeah.
Well, who are some of the other writers that you listened to and were influenced by around that period after you got to knowing about a score?
Oh.
Influences.
Well, it happened to have been a time when big bands were the thing. Probably you always thought, at that time, you thought it was going to always be like that. But there were some really good arrangers bands. Glenn Miller was one. Cy Oliver, particularly with Tommy, who's started to get one of the greatest bands. You know, it was a really dull band all through the 30s until he got bored with it and decided he wanted Cy Oliver and Buddy Rich and all the rest. And it became, I think, the white band before Woody Herman, as far as the really good hot bands. You know, this is besides all the great black bands, of course. But, you know, so you had, you know, Cy Oliver. There were a lot of great role models, and I think a great deal of my early education was just doing takedowns of all these things, trying to figure out what the hell they really were doing. And sometimes I was right, sometimes I wasn't, but that's how I learned to do it, kind of. You learn to do it by screwing up, if you want to know the truth. Because the one thing he said is, Van said, be sure to get somebody to play your music, or you'll never know what you did, and you'll never know what you didn't do, you know. And you're in for a lot of rude awakenings. And one of the first bands I ever had play my music was a band that Al Cohn was in. And that's when I found out about Al Cohn. To this day, people don't know what a magnificent arranger he was, as well as one of the great wits in the world. And the first arrangement I brought in, like everybody, it was wrong for everybody. It was really a disaster. But he said, you know, you won't know what you did, whether it was good or whether that was. And if you've heard, and what I discovered also was, if you find somebody you like that sounded pretty good, okay, why, and so forth, and maybe if I took that and moved it over here, and you know, and it was that kind of a thing. You learn by screwing up is the truth. That's the only way, but if you don't hear it, somebody play it, you won't know. I can imagine, it's like, you know, being a playwright and having nobody perform it. You don't know if it's good, horrible, or mediocre, or whatever. And so, okay.
Yeah. Did you ever try to do any takedowns of any Ellington stuff? That would have been a challenge.
Yeah, I tried. Mm-hmm. Of all people, you know, Andre Previn put it beautifully. He said, you know, if I could look at a score, you know, Ravel, Debussy, or even another band, some other band, but you go see Ellington and he holds up a finger and three guys play a note and you say, what the hell is that? That was his, it's really that. Because it was something that was only in Duke's head. And he would give these vivid descriptions to people in the band. They didn't know what they were doing either, but that's what he wanted to hear. No, I never tried to. Well, I did try to do some of that, or try to approximate it, but you never can get it like Duke.
Yeah.
Not only that, Duke's not going to do it the same way each time either.
Yeah.
Boy, that's the one exception that doesn't prove the rule.
Yeah. Well, I'm curious, what we're going to do today, of course, is listen to John's music and look at some of the scores and do a little analyzation if we can. And you all have that CD that has some of the excerpts from his scores on there, and we're going to have the audio. Before we get into that, I wanted to ask one more question about getting started in the business here. Who gave you your start, and where did you get that start as far as being in the business of writing? Because you were a trumpet player originally, right?
Yeah. Uh-huh. I got a lot of, well, I went through the usual channels, you know. I worked with whatever rehearsal bands I could. And I was, I lost my father when I was 11 years old. And so my mother had to deal with, and we moved back to New York about the same time. We were living out here. And by the time we moved back to New York, I always hated New York as a kid. It was noisy, it was loud. I didn't realize at the time, being a child, that it was probably the greatest place in the world to live during the 30s and 20s. I didn't know that. But it was noisy, and they moved me out to LA here, and it was wonderful. In 1934, Los Angeles was the most bucolic place in the world. There were only two industries here, oil and the movies. No factories, no defense plants, and it was, you lived in a house, and it was really nice. And I said, you know, I'm going to live here from now on. But then my dad passed away. My mother never liked California, and she brought us back to New York, which I looked forward to with dread. But what I didn't know is I was going to be happy. I knew I wanted to be a musician by then. And my God, there was a big band every place in the world. And one of the first friends I met was, who was my age, was Marshall Robbins, who was the son of Jack Robbins. And Jack used to take us out to hear the bands, you know, while he was working, because we were both gung-ho about that. Went and saw, you know, Larry Clinton and Charlie Barnett up at the top of the Park Central and all those places. So I just didn't believe this turn of good fortune. And so that was my whole existence between, you know, going to boarding schools, which were dreadful. But I was, you know, I'd come in and see Van and try and write something during that time when I wasn't with him. And that was my whole existence. I was a lousy student and somehow got through. Don't ask me how.
Great. Okay. Well, we're going to start looking at and listening to some of the music now. And one of your most famous scores, in my opinion, was the one you did for a movie called The Sandpiper. And that was, what, 65?
Sandpiper, I think, was 64.
Uh-huh. Okay, 64. And we're going to hear the main title. We don't have a score to this, but we do have the movie. Hi, Debbie. Thanks for coming.
Uh-huh.
That's John's assistant, Debbie Byers.
She sure is.
Say hello to Debbie Byers.
Indispensable.
So we're going to see the movie of that with the soundtrack on it of the this cue called Main Title, which has the Shadow of Your Smile. Jack Sheldon is the
trumpet creeper.
Yeah. And at the end of it, it has another cue which is attached called the Deer Hunter. Mm-hmm. So you can get the idea.